Good evening.
My name is Erin Stoyle Mulholland, and on behalf of the Center for Ethics and Culture, I'd like to welcome you to the first installment of this year's Catholic Literature Series. Each fall since 2002, the Center for Ethics and Culture has sponsored this event, featuring a group of lectures focusing on literature in light of the Catholic tradition. The Center hopes to examine the role of literature in our society and to expose the Notre Dame community to the rich Catholic literary heritage. This year's Catholic Literature Series will focus on Shakespeare and his relationship to Catholicism. We have selected Shakespeare for many reasons. Though there is mounting evidence which suggests that Shakespeare was at least raised in a Catholic home, the extent of his Catholicism and its effect on his work are hotly debated. Even if Shakespeare was not definitively a Roman Catholic, the question of whether a Catholic ethos exists in his work is an important one and sparks a great deal of debate. Before I introduce our speaker, please mark your calendars for the next lecture in our series, scheduled for Tuesday, November 4th at 8 p.m. in 144 de Bartolo. Peter Holland will be giving a lecture on Shakespeare and David Garrick, Saint Temples and Jubilees. Tonight we welcome John Finnis, who is known for his work in moral, political, and legal theory, as well as constitutional law. John joined the Notre Dame Law School faculty in 1995. He earned his LLB from Adelaide University in Australia in 1961 and his doctorate from Oxford University as a Rhodes Scholar in 1965. At the University of Oxford, he held the positions of lecturer, reader, and a chaired professor in law for over four decades until 2010. In addition, he served as an associate in law at the University of California at Berkeley, as a professor of law at the University of Malawi, and as the Huber Distinguished Visiting Professor of Law at the Boston College Law School. He is admitted to the English Bar. Please join me in welcoming John Finnis.
Well, the idea that William Shakespeare was on good terms with some leading recusant Catholics, that's to say Catholics not reconciled to the state Protestant religion, and also associated with some notable Catholics who were parts of the anti-Catholic regime, and the idea that he wrote with intent to reflect their concerns, to memorialize their experiences, and to encourage them in the faith, that idea, those ideas, became for me a cogent working hypothesis while I was assisting Patrick Martin, jurist and law professor, oil and gas law, as well as legal philosophy professor in Baton Rouge, as he was documenting and bringing to light hitherto entirely unresearched life story of an Oxford University philosophy lecturer born only 2 years before Shakespeare. His name was William Sterrell, or Sterrell. Because that investigation revealed to us how Sterrell and the great earl and courtier for whom he worked as secretary from 1592 to 1628, the crypto-Catholic, or as they called these figures, Catholics who went to the Anglican ceremonies, at least sometimes, the Earl of Worcester. Sterrell, as Worcester's secretary, and Worcester, one or other, or both of them, were in association with all the seven of the persons alluded to, Patrick Martin and I came to realize, as birds, living or dead, in the great poem that lies in the chronological and spiritual center of Shakespeare's works, usually called Phoenix and Turtle. This poem appeared in print in mid-1601, and countless efforts have been made to penetrate its enigmas and identify its birds, especially its deceased protagonist birds, the phoenix, and her husband, the turtle dove. for whom the poem summons four other birds to a requiem, for which the poem then itself supplies the anthem and the lament. All this in the dimensions and the essential rhythmic pattern and structure reversed of the Catholic hymn that begins the Catholic Requiem, or began the Catholic Requiem, the Dies Irae. Now, available to you here tonight after this talk is the article that Patrick Martin and I published in the Times Literary Supplement a decade ago, identifying not only the Phoenix, who is Saint Anne Lyne, and the Turtle, her late husband, Roger Lyne, exiled to Belgium for his recusancy, but also all the other birds, each one a notable Catholic, besides or except the infamous anti-Catholic judge who sent Anne Lyne to the gallows at Tyburn, and then identified the poem's essential meanings as a whole and in each of its parts. And I hope that you will, if you haven't already read the article and the poem, or the poem and the article, you'll perhaps pick that up, read the wonderful poem, and the elaborate investigation, historical search for the meanings and identifications, which has not been seriously contested. The poem then celebrates outright recusancy in a poetic form which entirely successfully concealed its audacious central meaning and intent from the eyes of the state and its supporters and from other readers who for many centuries have been able to read the poem but know or suspect nothing of any of these characters. While it was, you might say, en clair to the rather few Catholics who knew the interlocking of the names and so could read outwards from the central Euclidean geometrical pun on the word line. To these readers, until the names and links became forgotten, it was lucid, I think, from end to end, clear to, as they would think, us, but not to our foes. All the double meanings are fully deniable, and the surface meanings have been appreciated for their astonishing richness and suggestiveness by countless readers down the centuries, who suspected, as I said, absolutely nothing of its central meaning and intent. And in this, it is only, I suggest, a uniquely compressed instance of something that is pervasive, or at least widespread, across Shakespeare's works as a whole, namely a crypt, so to call it, of Catholic characters and Catholic meanings lying beneath a cathedral of meanings sufficient to themselves, or seemingly so. So I think Shakespeare writes as a Catholic would, who wished himself and his plays to survive and participate in a public realm that regarded Catholic faith as an ongoing treason, not just metaphorically treason, but actually criminal treason to England. I gave three public lectures at the James Madison Institute in Princeton in 2010 that you can watch online, slips of the tongue and all, on Shakespeare's patriotic resistance, as I called it, that is, his intellectual resistance to the Protestant regime. After discussing Phoenix and Turtle and the near certainty that Worcester, the Earl of Worcester, with Sterrell as his intermediary, commissioned A Midsummer Night's Dream for the great court wedding of two daughters of his, and then commissioned As You Like It for the even greater court wedding of his son and heir in 1600, after that I touched substantially on Titus Andronicus, King John, King Lear, Macbeth, and Henry VIII, a list that includes a number of plays, often, I think quite mistakenly, thought to be proof that Shakespeare was not a Catholic. You can watch those lectures online at the URL, which is, I think, number 11 in the little bibliography of 13 items, which is on the sheets that I've left here. At the end of the list of works in which I expound the historical underpinnings of this historical reading of Shakespeare and some of the implications of those readings for understanding the plays, you'll see a couple of short essays of mine on Measure for Measure, Conversion and Mercy. But for tonight's reflections on the last things, I've decided to work on something new, and so I'll talk about mostly Richard III, with a few remarks about King Lear and about Henry VIII. I have to abbreviate drastically, so anyone interested is welcome to email me for a copy of the longer version. In outline, the doctrines referred to with the phrase the four last things are shared by Christians of all ages, but in some significant respects they had been put into question by the reformers who controlled the Elizabethan and the Jacobean state church, and who suppressed Catholicism. The Catholic faith about these matters was authoritatively articulated in the Catechism called for by the Council of Trent and published first in Latin and Italian in 1566, a year or so after Shakespeare's birth, and in French in 1568. The Catechism has a lot to say about the four last things. Firstly, perhaps, in its treatment of the article of the Creed, from thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. And it says this, I'm quoting from a not wholly adequate mid-19th century translation. In proof of the last judgment, it is enough to... This whole catechism is addressed to parish priests. In proof of the last judgment, it is enough to adduce the authority of the apostle, St. Paul, 2 Corinthians 5:10, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the proper things of the body according as he hath done, whether it be good or evil. In explaining this subject, the pastor should distinguish two different occasions on which everyone must appear in the presence of the Lord, to render an account of all his thoughts, words, and actions, and to receive immediate sentence from his judge. The first takes place when each one of us departs this life, for then one is instantly placed before the judgment seat of God, where all that one has ever done or spoken or thought during life shall be subjected to the justest examination. This is called the particular judgment. The second occurs when all human beings on the same day and in the same place shall stand together before the tribunal of their judge, that in the presence and hearing of all human beings of all times, each may know his final doom, judgment and sentence. The announcement of this judgment will constitute no small part of the pain and punishment of the wicked, whereas the good and just will derive great reward and consolation from the fact that it will then appear what each one was in life. And this is called the general judgment. As to the third of the four last things, the Catechism had taken it up in relation to an earlier article of the Creed, He Descended into Hell. It distinguishes hell, strictly and properly so called, from both, on the one hand, the abode into which the souls of the just before the coming of Christ the Lord were received, and where, without experiencing any sort of pain, but supported by the blessed hope of redemption, they enjoyed peaceful repose, and on the other hand, from the fire of purgatory, in which the souls of just men are cleansed by a temporary punishment in order to be admitted into their eternal homeland, into which nothing defiled entereth, a doctrine the truth of which, as a doctrine founded on Scripture and confirmed by apostolic tradition, demands from the pastor exposition all the more diligent and frequent, because we live in times when men endure not sound doctrine. And in fact, the doctrine of purgatory, and with it the admissibility and worth of praying for the dead, were all strongly condemned by the Elizabethan state church. The last line of Phoenix and Turtle, with its stressed first syllable, "For these dead birds sigh, a prayer, imperatively invites, urges, and commands its readers, all who are true or fair, to pray for the dead birds, whom all know to be human persons, and some could judge to be Anne and Roger Lyon. Thus the poet sets himself and his inward readers decisively against the state religion's urgings. Let us not therefore dream either of purgatory or of prayer for the souls of them that be dead, to quote from one of the homilies appointed by the Elizabethan government to be preached, in essence, all the year round in every parish church in England. About the last and greatest of the four last things, the Roman Catechism has far more to say than about the others, and it urges pastors to preach often, fully and vividly about Christ's resurrection, the resurrection of the body at the Last Judgment, and the communion of saints. Elizabethan and Jacobean Catholic priests, despite the very adverse circumstances in which they preached, always hidden and in danger of arrest and execution, surely did what they could, and doubtless much more than their leisured modern-day successors in our communities, to make the glory and joy of the life to come a real and attractive object of hope and motive for choices aspiring to become, as St. Paul so often urges us, fit for it. Well, Richard III, the play, written within a year or two, one side or other, of 1594, was probably about the eighth of Shakespeare's plays, and certainly the longest and most ambitious he had written by then. And it remains the second or fourth longest of the 37 plays in his canon, depending on how you count. A wealth of modern commentary brings out not only the primacy of Thomas More's unfinished History of Richard III as Shakespeare's source, and the play's brilliant exploration of Machiavellianism, dissimulation, irony, and conscience, themes evident in More's path-breaking biography, but also the play's relation to the Senecan dramatic condition, a tradition of Nemesis transformed in the play into a Christian providence. But astonishingly, I think, modern commentary has scarcely noticed how that transformation extends into a fully deliberate clustering and thematizing of the images and conceptual elements of the Christian four last things, and that by tour de force of essentially philosophical insight or grip, these, death, judgment, heaven, and hell, are carefully shown as intrinsically related to conscience in its central proper instance, that is, right judgment, including where appropriate self-condemnation in both its aspects, of self, by self, by image clusters and suggestions which work partly subliminally but partly explicitly and are certainly by the author's design, divine judgment is made to appear so tightly correlated to one's conscience's judgments on oneself that playgoer and reader take divine judgment as, in effect, what it actually is, the objective, transcendent correlate of the individual soul's, person's, truthful self-assessment. Now, one can enter this lowest level of the play, the crypt, so to speak, of the play, at any point along its length, and then go backwards or forwards from there. Often Shakespeare makes the allusions he has been deploying only really evident or clinched near the very end, though they were present and could be sensed more or less tentatively or provisionally from the beginning. Phoenix and Turtle is a case in point. At stanza 16 of the 18, the iceberg comes close to breaking the surface. So I'll start at the beginning of the final act, Act 5, Scene 1, which is just 30 lines long. The Duke of Buckingham is being led to his execution by the sheriff, the local officer of the king. Buckingham has, for the whole play's length, been King Richard's principal colleague and co-conspirator, as Richard makes his way, hacks his way by dissimulation and homicide to the throne. Buckingham, motivated, it seems, by hatred of the Queen's relatives around the throne, Queen of Edward IV, his predecessor, the Woodville family, led by her brother Lord Rivers, guardian of her son Edward, the legitimate heir to the throne, Buckingham has shown himself ingenious, bold, and resourceful. At our first glimpse of their criminal association, Richard addresses Buckingham as my other self, my counsel's consistory, my prophet, and so forth. Though Richard lets us know at the outset that he regards Buckingham too as a simple gull, a dupe among dupes. The little soliloquy in Act 1, Scene 3, in which Richard imparts this assessment, ends, and thus I clothe my naked villainy with odd old ends, bits and pieces, stolen forth out of holy writ, and seem a saint when most I play the devil. Now, Buckingham's greatest triumph was his brilliant performance with Richard of an extended, farcically cynical charade calculated to fool the citizens of London by presenting Richard as a deeply devout Christian man of conscience, fit and ready to clean up the realm after the real and fabricated debaucheries of the late King Edward, his elder brother, the eldest brother. For this tour de force, perhaps above all, Richard makes Buckingham central to his own enthronement, his pomp and triumph in Act 4, Scene 2. Telling everyone else to stand aside, Richard ascends the throne hand in hand with Buckingham, sits and then proclaims, thus high by thy advice and thy assistance is King Richard seated. But shall we wear these glories for a day, or shall they last and we rejoice in them? And Buckingham's answer is, still, that's to say perpetually, still live they, and forever let them last. Now this glories rejoicing forever is a murmur of the play's ground base of allusions to the four last things, death, doom, pain, and joy, as they're called in Thomas More's little treatise on them. Meanwhile, at the play's fast-moving surface, Richard, then and there, on the throne for the first time, in a stage whisper, asks Buckingham to join him in murdering the princes in the Tower, the 13-year-old legitimate heir to Edward IV and his 9-year-old brother. Buckingham stalls, evades, asks for the reward that Richard had long ago promised, and then, when refused, flees to join those preparing rebellion against Richard's illegitimate rule. Buckingham's rebellion looks threatening for a time, but is overwhelmed by floods, he is captured, and he's brought to Salisbury for execution. So Act 5 opens with Buckingham speaking to the sheriff. And then, as if addressing 8 of Richard's victims, he imagines that they and all that have miscarried, died by underhand, corrupted, foul injustice, if that your moody, discontented souls do through the clouds behold this present hour, even for revenge mark my destruction. It is his backward and forward-looking conscience speaking, acknowledging his part in Richard's underhand injustices, and looking through its, that's to say, his own judgments to the transcendent world. And his next line addresses again the sheriff. This is All Souls' Day, fellow, is it not? It is. Why then All Souls' Day is my body's doomsday, the day of particular judgment? He recalls that in the reconciliation staged managed by the dying King Edward in Act 2, Scene 1, he, Buckingham, had underlined the purported authenticity of his own promise of reconciliation by making a show of begging God that if ever he should fail in his duteous love to the king's family, he might himself be betrayed by the person he himself most trusted. So now, on his way to the scaffold, he says, this This All Souls Day to my fearful soul is the determined respite, the delayed endpoint, of my wrongs. That high all-seer that I dallied with hath turned my feigned prayer on my head and given in earnest what I begged in jest. Thus doth he force the swords of wicked men to turn their own points on their master's bosoms. He aligns his judgment on himself with what he takes to be God's, the high all-seer's, providential judgment and disposition of things. His acknowledgement of divine providence will reach its most lapidary and universal form, of course, in Hamlet's "There's a divinity that shapes our ends, rough-hew them how we will," though Hamlet and Horatio, who ratifies the proposition, leaves unstated the justice that Buckingham makes explicit. Not that Buckingham or Shakespeare are suggesting that this justice always, or even usually, works out visibly and in this world, only that it may, or may reasonably be taken to. And when it does, it functions as a kind of symbol of a more perfect justice that cannot be expected this side of the day of general judgment. There is no gigantic machine of Christian order at work, oppressive and deterministic, as some modern critics say, in this or other plays which allude to providence and offer to symbolize a fragment of its workings. Still less has this anything to do with the fate that some modern critics say is in charge of the play. So look again at the backdrop of All Souls Day, that great medieval Catholic feast day utterly suppressed by the state religion that repudiated purgatory and prayer for the dead and expunged All Souls Day from the calendars and almanacs of the Elizabethans. In medieval popular piety, this was a day not only for the living to pray for the dead, but also for the souls, or some of the souls of those in purgatory, to revisit the world of the living and appear as ghosts. St. Thomas Aquinas accepts that such souls by divine dispensation can appear, especially perhaps in the popular pious version, to those by whom they, the ghosts, had been wronged during their lifetime. Shakespeare makes such a ghostly visitation to both Richard and Richmond, a first element of the double climax of the play's final act, Act 5, Scene 3, on the eve of the Battle of Bosworth that will see Richmond become king after Richard has been defeated and has been slain by Richmond in combat. The first part of the double climax is the simultaneous appearance to both Richard and Richmond, each asleep in his tent on opposite sides of the stage, of 11 men, women, and children murdered or unjustly killed by Richard. 9 of them in the course of this play, the other 2 in the preceding play in the set of 4 that is concluded by Richard III. Each ghost calls not for revenge or even vengeance or retribution as such, but for his own presence to sit heavy on Richard's soul and thoughts in the coming battle, and for Richard to despair and die. In height of all his pride, says the ghost of Buckingham last of all. Only been dead a few hours. On Richmond, on the other hand, they urge confidence, and they solicit the assistance of good angels. And there immediately follows the scene's second and greater climax, when Richard, awakening suddenly, first calls on Jesus, which indeed is the only time that Jesus is seriously addressed in the whole of Shakespeare, for mercy, and then instantly denounces his own coward conscience, and then launches into 22 lines of dialogue within himself, towards the end of which his conscience, as he says, takes on 1,000 tongues, one for each tale and tally of his wickedness, so that in the end, predicting his own final despair, he concludes that no one will pity him in his death, since that I myself find in myself no pity for myself. This unparalleled depiction of conscience's place in the soul as an aspect, but only an aspect, of oneself has been prepared for by many mentions of conscience in earlier scenes, as I shall soon recall. And it's not the last. Shakespeare has saved up to the last Richard's open descent into explicit proto-Nietzschean genealogical deconstruction and renunciation of conscience. It's in his final address to his officers. Let not our babbling dreams affright our souls. Conscience is but a word that cowards use, devised at first to keep the strong in awe. That's the whole of Nietzsche's genealogy of morals, account of conscience. Our strong arms be our conscience, swords our law. March on, join battle bravely. Let us to it, pell-mell, if not to heaven, then hand in hand to hell. The self-assessment presupposed in this acknowledgement that hell awaits is itself, of course, a working of conscience, which is, after all, no more and no less than a rational judgment on the quality of one's options, or present or past actions. The play's engagements with conscience began early, but later than its intimations of heaven and hell, which begin explicitly in its very first scene and are linked with divine judgment in the second scene, when Anne Mortimer reminds her seducer, Richard, that thou mayst be damned for the wicked deed, reminds her seducer, Richard, that thou mayst be damned for the wicked deed of murdering the King Henry VI, whose encoffined corpse on its way from St. Paul's lies between the two of them. In the event, that's to say by the time the scene has ended, she agrees to marry him, endures countless nights made sleepless by his fearful dreams, and is murdered by him as she had foretold. In the first act's third scene, Henry VI's widow, Queen Margaret, in an aside to the audience, says Richard's proper kingdom is in hell, where he belongs, as a cacodemon, an evil, evil spirit. She extends and magnifies the play's great series of curses that began with Anne Neville's On Richard, and she will articulate the theology of these curses eventually to Richard. They are not mere attempted magic, rather, as she says first to Buckingham when he declares them an empty breath, rather, her thought is that these curses ascend the sky and there awake God's gentle sleeping peace. A thesis well in line, as we know, with Buckingham's eventual chastened final view of the matter. Her definitive plea, though she admits it expresses her hunger for revenge, is the play's defining judgment on Richard's place in the real earthly cum transcendent scheme of things. Richard yet lives hell's black intelligencer, only reserved their factor, that's to say, only preserved as the demon's commercial agent, to buy souls and send them thither. But at hand ensues his piteous and unpitied end. Earth gapes, hell burns, fiends roar, saints pray to have him suddenly conveyed from hence. Cancel his bond of life, dear God, I plead, that I may live and say, the dog is dead. And those were the very words spoken about Richard by Richmond, the only words spoken about Richard by Richmond after he had slain Richard and won the crown, the bloody dog is dead. A minute after Margaret's defining pronouncement on him, Richard and his regime with trumpeters and drummers pass by on their way to do battle with Richmond, and are intercepted by the three great women, the two former queens of England and his own mother. And when eventually he's left alone with the widowed Queen Elizabeth, Richard sets out on a seduction as ambitious, at least, as that which won Anne Neville to be the wife whom he has just had privily murdered. And now he will seek to persuade King Edward's widow, Queen Elizabeth Woodville, to authorize and persuade her daughter, Princess Elizabeth, to marry him. With my soul I love thy daughter and do intend to make her Queen of England. Shakespeare makes this extended dialectic between two powerful intellects recall to us or articulate for us with his matchless penetration and brevity two realities that will soon be brought into relationship with each other in Richard's final judgment on himself when, as we now know, instead of responding to his conscience's demand for several tongues, accurately reminding him of his wrongs and demanding repentance of those wrongs, instead of responding to that while he still can, he instead makes the final self-determining resolution of his inner debate this: I shall despair, since that I myself find in myself no pity to myself, to myself. Elizabeth Woodville, in her debate with him on his march to battle, had summed it all up when he offered to swear to the honesty of his intentions for her daughter. She says, "Swear then by something that thou hast not wronged, Richard. Then by myself, Elizabeth, thyself is self-misused." So that's the first of the two realities or truths about conscience. And some further aspects of it are developed near the end of this remarkable debate seduction scene. The other reality is put by Shakespeare in between. It is Richard's declaration, bringing into unblinking daylight the secrets of many a conscience: as I intend to prosper and repent. This is how even an otherwise perceptive conscience, hitherto perhaps free from rationalizations, can most potently blind itself and oneself with an all-embracing rationalization. After the success, as I hope, of my immoral chosen purpose, and after getting the benefits of that success, I will repent of that choice and purpose. And so in the end, all will be well with me, and also with those for whose benefit perhaps I was knowingly doing this evil. It is not quite the form of rationalization of doing evil for the sake of good that St. Paul identifies in Romans 3, 5 and 6, 1, and denounces in Romans 3, 8, but it's not far away. And as a scheme, it's easier said than done. And here one can mention that one way the play keeps up its ground base about conscience and conscience's objective correlate is by Richard's seven oaths by St. Paul, by Holy Paul, by the Apostle Paul. For that is precisely a theme of St. Paul's greatest epistle, the one I just mentioned, to the Romans, in the passage, chapter 2, verses 1 to 15, to which, as much as anything, this passage, our civilization owes both the very word conscience, verse 15, and the truth that on that day when God judges the secrets of men, the day of wrath when God's true and righteous judgment will be revealed, on that day our conscience's judgments for and against us will excuse or accuse each of us. And that's the play's great under theme. The first of the seven Pauline oaths is in Act 1, Scene 1, and it's long overdue time for me to remind you again that all these Act 4 and Act 5 correlations of providence and conscience have been amply prepared for in Act 1. This is done in many ways, but with maximum expository explicitness in the astounding last scene of the first act. Richard's brother, his next elder brother, George, Duke of Clarence, recounts to his jailer, Brackenbury, his dream of drowning, dying, and going to hell, environed by a legion of foul fiends, but only after seeing in the kingdom of perpetual night first the father he had betrayed, and then the shadow like an angel of Edward, son of Henry VI and Margaret, who cries out for furies to seize and take to torment false, fleeting, perjured Clarence that stabbed me in the field by Tewkesbury. "Ah, Brackenbury," says Clarence to his jailer, "I have done these things that now give evidence against my soul." Soon Brackenbury, on Richard's orders, abandons Clarence, now sleeping, to the two men Richard has sent to murder him. As Clarence sleeps on, the two murderers fall to discussing the great judgment day and the kind of remorse bred in one of them, at least, by mention of that phrase. From this, they transit naturally enough to discussing conscience with jokey nervousness, and one of them delivers 9 long semi-farcical lines about the ways in which conscience makes a man a coward by its accusations, its checks, its detections, and its mutinies, and so forth. He resolves to trust himself and live without it, but then Clarence awakes and, to save his life, appeals to the prospect of divine judgment on them if they murder him. The long ensuing dialectic about his own misdeeds and the murderer's war with God is ended only by the murder. The conscience of one of the murderers then revives imperiously and immediately, and he renounces his fee, convincingly exclaiming repentance for this most grievous guilty murder done, and wishing that, like Pilate, he could wash his hands of it. Now, the literary bravura, or genius, of the 50 or 60 lines of Clarence's recounting of his dream make this one of Shakespeare's greatest evocations of interiority, of the rational soul, qua imaginative and remembering and intelligent, as an inner space open to the vast spaces of the world and to the so much vaster spaces of the divine kingdom and its hellish counterpart, and over, beyond, and within everything, open simply to Almighty God. Against the awesomeness and resonances of this, the conceptual precisions about and the investigations of conscience and the four last things unfold all the more fruitfully, filling out this long play's almost constantly perceptible subterranean level from its beginning to its end. Well, you'll ask about heaven. It's there, but for want of time, let me move away from this play of Shakespeare's earliest maturity to his last, for perhaps his most daring evocation of heaven, without, however, pretending for a moment to cross its threshold, is in his final play, Henry VIII, or All is True, his only open engagement with the Reformation, and one that severely embarrasses Shakespeare was a Catholic critics on account of its final scene, in which Archbishop Cranmer, founder of the state church, lyrically foretells the glorious and Protestant rule of Elizabeth and James. In the third of my 3 Princeton lectures of 2010, I set out strong reasons to believe, instead, that this final scene, putting it in its proper historical context, was audacious, bitter, ironizing, that every Catholic in the audience will have recognized it as such, and that the play trashes Henry, and by implication Cranmer, as inveterate liars, while glorifying the Catholic Catherine of Aragon, first real wife of Henry VIII, mother of Queen Mary I, Mary Tudor, Bloody Mary to the Elizabethans. Well, I can't recount here the evidence for these judgments, but I will recount the play's presentation of Catherine's preliminary welcoming to heaven before her death. In the last scene of the penultimate act, Queen Catherine is sitting mortally ill, alone with her faithful gentleman usher Griffiths and her woman Patience. She has been shown throughout the play as dignified, intelligent, actively concerned for the common good and the king alike, and loyal and dutiful to her husband Henry VIII, even as he is swayed first by the corrupt Cardinal Wolsey to murder the Duke of Buckingham by corrupt legal process, and then, as he, Henry, is led by his own lusts to bring down Catherine herself, again by corrupt legal process. She now speaks to Griffith the harsh truth about Wolsey, but welcomes Griffith's offer to say what can be said in his favour. When that's done, she commends Griffith as an honest chronicler and says, "Whom I most hated living, thou hast made me with thy religious truth and modesty, now in his ashes. Honor, peace be with him." Summoning music, she falls asleep, and Griffith and Patience nod off. There appears the vision, elaborately described in a stage direction 145 words long, of six personages clad in white robes, bearing garlands and branches of bay or palm, who bow to her, dance about her, holding garlands over her head, each in turn in pairs, passing the garlands to the next pair, so that she is crowned with garlands thrice, while in her sleep, as it were by inspiration, she makes signs of rejoicing and holds up her hands to heaven. And then they vanish, but the music continues, and she wakes. Her attendants have not seen the vision, but we have. And she tells them that the blessed troop invited her to a banquet and promised her eternal happiness, bringing her garlands, which I feel I am not worthy yet to wear. The king's messenger enters to convey the king's empty and perfunctory good wishes. She returns them more believably and gives the messenger a letter she has written to the king, in which she has commended to his goodness the model of our chaste loves, his young daughter, that is, Mary, to whom, in an early, brief, intense parallel to Cranmer's long and untrue speech over the baby Elizabeth, Catherine seeks heaven's blessings and the king's service of a virtuous upbringing, befitting Mary's noble, modest nature. Petitions which are made serious and emotionally intense by the scene's glorification of her own faith, integrity, and faith, the faith. She then makes dispositions for her women, payment of their wages and something more. Her last words to the messenger are, "Tell him, Henry, in death I blessed him, for so I will." She is led from the stage to her deathbed, the indisputable heroine, indeed the indisputable heroic figure of the play. Geoffrey Bulloh, in his learned and indispensable eight-volume narrative and dramatic sources of Shakespeare in volume 4, says the garland dance which she sees in her vision indicates her saintliness, a remarkable thing for a Jacobean dramatist to admit in a Spanish Catholic. And the attached footnote repeats the word remarkable. But Bulloh hasn't seen, and I don't know if anyone has, that the vision may well be inspired by the treatment of Catherine in the polemical, fiercely anti-Protestant English Catholic History of the Reformation by Nicholas Sander and Edward Rishton, priests, De Origine Ac Progressus Schismatis Anglicani, 1585, Cologne, which describes Catherine's trials and mistreatment and then says, "Hoc persecutiones generae Deo visum est immarcescibilem illi gloriae coronem prepararis." Now, since the overwhelmingly primary meaning of corona in both classical and Christian Latin is garland, the word that is used six times in the stage direction, we should read Sanders as saying that by persecution of this kind, God arranged to prepare for her an imperishable garland. The garland, wreath or crown of glory. And Sanders is echoing the Vulgate, St. Jerome's Latin translation of the first epistle of St. Peter, chapter 5, where St. Peter, quite possibly in 59 AD with Luke as his penman, is assuring those who have humility and do not lord it over subjects and share in the sufferings of those who keep the faith, assuring them that when the Lord appears, you will receive an unfading garland, the immarcescibilem gloriae coronam. As usual, Shakespeare has doubled up his references to what most matters to him. So his staging of the virtual taking up to heaven of Bloody Mary's Spanish Catholic mother after fraudulent court proceedings in Act 4 was prepared for by Act 2's staging of the walk to the scaffold after fraudulent court proceedings of the virtuous Duke of Buckingham. As if looking back to the same walk by this good Duke's villainous, though perhaps repentant, father, the Buckingham in Richard III, Shakespeare treats us again to his thesis about the objective correlativity of right human conscience and ultimate divine judgment. Buckingham says, "I have this day received a traitor's judgment, and by that name must die. Yet heaven bear witness, and if I have a conscience, let it sink me, even as the axe falls, if I be not faithful. You few that loved me and dare be bold to weep for Buckingham, his noble friends and fellows, whom to leave is only bitter to him only dying, go with me like good angels to my end, and as the long divorce of steel falls on me, make of your prayers one sweet sacrifice and lift my soul to heaven. Lead on in God's name. The long divorce of England from its old faith, motivated by Henry's long divorce proceedings, instituted because, as the play tells us, his conscience crept too close to Anne Boleyn and became a mere extension and rationalization of his lust, lies behind Shakespeare's decision to tell the story of the English Reformation as he does, as principal player to the King James, whose policy, defying all the promises he had made before his accession, was to repress Catholicism as firmly as Elizabeth did, a policy excoriated 7 years earlier in 1605 in King Lear, as I argue at length in my second Princeton lecture of 2010. The intimation, finally, of heaven in King Lear is given by Lear, the healed, reformed, converted Lear, when he and his daughter Cordelia, the play's almost open symbol of Catholicism over and against state church Protestantism and Puritanism, respectively, he and his daughter Cordelia are ordered to prison by the usurping Machiavel, seducer of both those sisters, Edmund. Lear brushes aside Cordelia's concern about seeing her sisters. Come, let's away to prison. We two alone will sing like birds in the cage. When thou dost ask me blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. So we'll live and pray and sing and tell old tales and laugh at gilded butterflies and hear poor rogues talk of court news. And we'll talk with them too. Who loses? Who wins? Who's in? Who's out? And take upon us the mystery of things, as if we were God's spies. And we'll wear out in a walled prison packs and sects of great ones that ebb and flow by the moon. Take them away, says Edmund. Upon such sacrifices, my Cordelia, the gods themselves throw incense. This passage, one of Shakespeare's supreme achievements, seems plainly to echo the trope developed by Robert Southwell in the 8th letter of his Epistle of Comfort. St. Robert Southwell, canonized on the same day as Anne Lyon in 1917, wrote the Epistle of Comfort for Philip Arundel, the imprisoned eldest son of the Countess of Arundel, who died in the same year in the Tower as a martyr and was canonized again on the same day in 1970. And in this Epistle of Comfort, Southwell, the priest, develops the trope of the cage, not just a cage, but the cage, in which are imprisoned birds who sing in the cage, though with a senseless unawareness, the birds, of what we reasonable creatures and Christians, Catholic, should know. Namely, that imprisonment, especially of the guiltless for their faith, has inestimable advantages as a sure way to an unspeakable glory of the world to come. And in Southwell's book as a whole, conscience and heaven are linked in the way that we should now expect. He says, we must not esteem how we are judged of men, but how acceptable we are unto God, who is the only umpire, of whom we must look for the final verdict upon all our actions. He that like the sun carrieth his light within him may say with St. Paul, Gloria nostra testimonium conscientiae nostrae, our glory is the testimony of our conscience. Howsoever he may with a cloud of disgrace and malicious slanders be covered from men's eyes, yet can his light be never so darkened, but that parter qui videt in abscondito rendit illi. Our Father which seeth in secret will reward him, Matthew 6. And in the day of judgment shall he shine like the sun itself in the view of the whole world. Like the Roman Catechism, Southwell holds that, in his words, in heaven all the senses are evermore and without fear of loss, fully satisfied with their several pleasures and drowned in the depth of unspeakable delight. More clearly even than in the Catechism's extended and enthusiastic account of the joys of the resurrection of the body, however, Southwell articulates what is associational in the heavenly condition, of which he generally speaks, as it should be supposed to be, before the last and general judgment and the resurrection of the body as a realm of souls. Besides men, we shall have the company of so many choirs of angels, of Our Lady, Christ, and the Most Blessed Trinity, and these so beautiful to see, so amiable and loving to converse with, that we shall no less joy of our company than of our own glory. And he speaks, as goes without saying, on the hypothesis and the hope of perseverance by divine grace in faith and love, in thoughts, words, and deeds until death. John Klaus, professor of English, who came close to identifying the structure of Phoenix and Turtle, although he didn't identify the characters, has a splendid book, Shakespeare, the Earl and the Jesuit, different Earl, not the Earl of Worcester, but the Earl of Southampton, the younger friend of the Earl of Worcester, in which he shows extensively that Shakespeare must have read intently roughly all of Southwell's works, both published and clandestine, unpublished. Well, there we are. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Finnis. Does anybody have any questions at this time?
To what extent does Shakespeare's emphasis on conscience that you...
Sorry, what?
To what extent does Shakespeare's emphasis on the idea of conscience support or provide evidence for the hypothesis that he's a Catholic? That is there something about a particular notion of conscience that supports that as opposed to being a Protestant or a Christian?
Nothing very direct. Catholics of the time considered that Calvinism, which was the form that Protestantism took in the state church, radically more Calvinist than Anglicanism became after about 1615 or 1620, when it began a kind of partial re-Catholicizing. Catholics considered that Calvinism, with its official denial of freedom of choice, free will, corrupted conscience and promoted immorality. Calvinists had a response to this. But that was the Catholic understanding of the matter, and it has a kind of basis to it. So, of course, it's not the case that the Protestants of the period denied the reality of conscience, but conscience is massively a part of the Catholic self-understanding of their own stance in the world. From Thomas More on, not just, of course, on the famous one or two occasions in public, but massively throughout his works, and extensively through the polemical anti-Protestant Catholic literature produced in England or by Englishmen outside England in the period. So it's simply concordant with the... and strongly concordant, but not decisive in any way by itself. Yeah.
Thank you very much for your talk. Fascinating. I'm no expert in the field, and that's actually what my question is about. I find these ideas tremendously exciting. I was the other day discussing them with a colleague, and she disagreed with me quite sharply, and unfortunately she has tenure as in in early modern English literature. And I don't. So this was embarrassing. But so what I'm wondering from you is, what has been the response to this interpretation of the Shakespearean canon? Because
sorry, what is what the
what? So what has been the response?
Response? Well, there isn't just one Shakespeare as a Catholic sort of hypothesis out there. There are several, a number. They have been being developed in various forms since the second half of the 19th century. There's been a kind of explosion, a semi-industry of them in the last 15 or 20 years. People coming from various directions. What has, in my view, most hampered the development of an interpretation or reading of Shakespeare on the hypothesis that he was a Catholic is the inadequacy of the standard historical accounts of the period in which he lived. And an example of this is the extremely interesting work of Claire Asquith, who shares with me, or I share with her, a view which is not shared by many of the other Shakespeare as a Catholic interpreters, namely that it's of little interest and little value to spot occasional lines which have some sort of, or may have some sort of Catholic meaning. If there's a Catholic Shakespeare, then what he's doing is constructing whole plays which have this double level. And the lower level that's visible to the Catholics in the audience, who may be half the audience, or half the courtly audience, and Shakespeare's plays were all written, I think, for courtly performance rather than, in the first instance, in the Globe. So half the audience, half the courtly audience are crypto-Catholics, and they will be sensing the underground meaning right across the play from beginning to end, especially, as I say, sometimes retrospectively. The clues come out strongly at the end, and then you look back, oh, God, yes. So she shares with me that hypothesis that you should be able to read whole plays, but in my view, with great respect for her, and I admire her, her history is entirely insufficient to bear the weight of the interpretation. The class of Catholics whom Patrick Martin and I particularly sort of stumbled on by following the life of William Sterrell is a class of Catholics who were regarded with contempt and hostility by the 19th and 20th century English Catholic historians who wrote the history of the Catholic thing in these eras. The Earl of Worcester is a prime example. So when Father Philip Caraman, in his wonderful biography of Father Henry Garnet, comes to give an account of Garnet's trial after his arrest after the gunpowder plot, says, and there was the Earl of Worcester on the panel, just back from suppressing a Catholic uprising in Wales, sinister figure. And that's the standard view of him. Now, when you see his whole life and see the extraordinary feats of his secretary Sterrell operating as a triple agent paid by both sides for Elizabeth and for the exiled English Catholics for 20 years while Worcester's secretary, you start to understand Worcester in a completely different light as a man who made himself appear shallow and acceptable in order to be deep and significant. Now, unless you know that, then you can't possibly understand what's going on in Midsummer Night's Dream, written for the wedding of his daughters, and you can't understand what's going on in As You Like It, written for the wedding of his son. But when you do know, then if you've got two big strategic
comedies lined up with Catholic meanings, which is only possible if you know quite a lot of history that is just not in the books yet. Then you've got something to build on. And it was from moving from that that we found Phoenix and Turtle. And Phoenix and Turtle takes you right into the heart of the mystery, because, you know, from beginning to end, you have this profound lament for a saintly Catholic woman who was executed just 3 or 4 months before the poem appears in public as part of a collection of poems put together for an ex-Catholic courtier who's just been knighted, and this is to celebrate his knighthood, and his PA has invited the top poets in the country to put in a poem for him, and they do, and Ben Jonson and others, they put in poems which sort of snigger about his adulteries and so on, because he was a notorious philanderer. And Shakespeare puts in this astounding hymn to married chastity, which summons up, just for the ordinary reader, a remarkable sort of feeling of something metaphysical or possibly transubstantiational about going on, but I'm not sure what, and I don't know what's going on, don't really know what's going on. And then it turns out you can identify everything, and you've got a coherent account of an event, the lives of two saintly young people who both became Catholics, were disinherited by their Protestant families for their marriage, or for their becoming Catholics and for marrying each other. A few weeks or months after their marriage, the cops bust in and arrested the priest who was saying Mass for them. He got hanged, castrated, emboweled, disemboweled, and so on in the usual routine way. And the husband was exiled to Belgium and lived on a small Spanish pension thereafter. And she started managing the housing stock of the English Jesuits hiding in London. And then eventually, on Candlemas Day 1600, she is bussed by the cops, sent by the Chief Justice, his cops, and he then conducts the trial and tells the jury to convict her, and she's executed. And then Shakespeare writes his lament for her. And at the lament, he summons up the greatest Catholic, greatest composer of the age, William Byrd, and Father Henry Garnet, Father William Page, who was at the Mass and who escaped, and says to that Byrd, that Popham, the Chief Justice, must stay away, and the only member of the tyrant wing, the regime, who can come to the Requiem is, and then he gives a coded description of the Earl of Worcester. So it's, but unless you know the history, none of that is possible. None of that history, or very little of that history, is in the main books. It's real history, and we've read all the documents and so on, and we will eventually publish a properly, you know, documented account. But when you see it, then you say, yes, as my tenured English faculty colleague in University College, who's just now a big chaired professor in Cambridge, late medievalist, said, yes, got it. totally unexpected.
Yeah. John, right at the same time, 1590s, turn of 1600, he's also writing a play set 150 years before his own time, in which he's writing the namesakes of these characters. Worcester appears in the first part of Henry IV. The Lord Chief Justice appears in the second part of that series. Any clues as to...
Different Worcesters.
Oh, certainly, but...
Yeah, no, but different family. The Somerset... Edward Worcester, Edward Somerset, 4th Earl of Worcester, the first Earl in that line came in with Henry VII, with Richmond, and is the last of the Beauforts, actually. He's the illegitimate, he's the last of the Beauforts. Queen Elizabeth recognised him as cousin, they were cousins, he had his, as his shield, the royal coat of arms. I mean, this is like that in your face, because he could trace his line all the way back to John of Gaunt and thus Edward III.
It struck me that at the same time that Anne and her husband are carried off, roughly at that same time, here he's writing about folks who carry the same title. And I wondered if there was any.
I don't think it's direct like that. But the project of writing about English history, which is a fascinating one, the very first is King John. I mean, of course, King John is probably written, as it were, 12th or 11th in the series of plays. But the beginning of English history King Lear is back there, British history, but. The beginning of English history is King John, and what's King John? It's nothing about Magna Carta, it's all about the French invading and so on, and the astonishing role of the papal legate. And John surrenders the crown of England to the papal legate, and the papal legate bestows the crown back under sort of Roman terms. Now, this is all accompanied by a kind of anti-papal rhetoric by John, which satisfies the Protestants in the audience and a lot of critics and so on after this is an anti-Catholic play, but this is anti-papal rhetoric by John, and John has been identified from the first scene as a usurper and a villain who murders the legitimate and attractive teenage heir to the throne in a dire manner, which actually closely tracks the way Elizabeth behaved in respect of the execution of Mary Queen of Scots, where she got her private secretary to carry the warrant and then declared that she'd never meant it and had him put on trial outrageously for doing what he'd been told to do, which is all what happens in King John. And actually, that's one of the things that made the early mid-19th century English Catholics sort of start to prick up their ears and notice that Shakespeare wasn't the Protestant hero that he'd always been portrayed as. Yeah, lots and lots to be said. Yeah. But in general, the project of displaying English history, in which virtually everyone is, from beginning to end, is a Catholic, bad Catholics, good Catholics, wicked archbishops, who die in despair on the stage. After the Reformation, Bloody Mary comes back, and there's a wonderful era of humanistic Catholicism in England, cut off by her early death. And Elizabeth's reinstitution of Protestantism. Now, during that period, all serious Catholics reflected on the fact that all our bishops betrayed us under Henry VIII, except Fisher. Our church was corrupt. That's part of the deal. The modern sort of 20th century notion that people have that no Elizabethan Catholic could have spoken ill of other Catholics or priests, or bishops or popes is absurd. English Catholics of this class had to internalize and fully wrap their minds and spirits around the notion that the English Catholic Church had been led to destruction by its own calamitous failings and corruption of many of its people, not all. But many. And so to portray that on the stage, the triumphs and follies of Catholics and their evil and their saintliness and so on, I think was the project, but is done so skillfully. I mean, the way in which in Richard II, he puts a little hymn to Mary and to England as Mary's dowry, in such a way that English Protestant Englishmen have been reciting this hymn at speeches for centuries without working out the syntax of the sentence which gives you
the meaning that England is celebrated as Mary's dower. But once you work out the syntax and allow yourself to think it, you say, yeah, he meant it. There's no way he didn't mean it. He put it there. Yeah. A fantastic feat.
All right, well, thank you everyone for joining us today, and thanks again to Professor Finnis for his lovely remarks.